Asia. Copies of Mr. Friedman's book, Flashpoints, The Emerging Crisis of Europe, will be available for sale and signing after the program from our partners at the bookseller. Before we begin, some quick housekeeping points. We are on the record this evening. We welcome social media, but we ask you to please silence your phones. We're also live streaming this evening. And I should mention that last time Mr. Friedman was here, we also live streamed the event, and it was uploaded to a German website and got more hits than any other council video in our history, so no pressure this evening. We have upcoming programs at the council in the month of March include Tuesday, March 8th. The Council on Foreign Relations, Adam Siegel, will be in conversation with UI Labs CEO Caroline Nowinski-Collins to discuss how the cyber realm is reshaping international relations. On Wednesday, March 23rd, The Washington Post's David Ignatius will be discussing lessons from the Syrian civil war for US policymaking. And on Thursday, March 31st, Yale economist Jeffrey Garton and the Financial Times' Edward Luce will be discussing the past and the future of globalization. The Council is a public education institution generously funded by its members and donors, and our aim is to make conversations like this evening's open to as wide an audience as possible, so we thank you for making that possible. Turning back to this evening's program, I'll return later to moderate the audience Q&A. But first, to introduce the topic and the speaker, please join me in welcoming the chairman of Satter Investment Management and a good friend of the Chicago Council, Mr. Munir Satter.
Thank you, Ian. And good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm delighted to welcome today George Friedman back to the Chicago Council on Global Affairs. And George, let's see if you can beat George from last year in this live streaming. George last year spoke at the Council and focused on Europe's complex security challenges. This was in the weeks after the Charlie Hebdo attacks, when Russia was engaged in military action in eastern Ukraine, and Syriza had just been elected, raising fresh fears of a Greek exit from the Eurozone. At the time, George had struck a cautionary note, questioning whether Europe had the unity or shared sense of destiny to hold together in the face of such crises. A year on, and the situation looks more unstable, and Europe's response has not inspired confidence. But today, this disorder can be seen to varying degrees across the entire Eurasian landmass, an area of 5 billion people covering Europe, the Middle East, Russia, China, and Central Asia. Interstate conflict over land resources, rising extremism, weakening alliances, and economic instability are undermining security from the Aegean to the South China Sea. Most worryingly, as George will discuss tonight, these crises today are merging and they are intensifying. The ongoing migrant crisis, for example, is at the nexus of a complex set of interconnected challenges linking Russia's military resurgence, conflicts from Afghanistan to Ukraine, the rise of ISIS, and growing discord in Europe. What underlying political, economic, or cultural forces are driving these crises? How might this geopolitical instability shape the foreign and defense policies of America's next president? Given the complexity of these questions, I'm glad George is back at the Council this evening to unravel the threads of Eurasia's geopolitics. By brief way of introduction, George is founder and chairman of Geopolitical Futures, his new company focused on explaining and predicting the future of international affairs for the public. He's also a New York Times best-selling author and regular contributor to discussions on international political issues for major networks such as CNN, Fox News, and NPR. And he's the author of numerous books on warfare and intelligence. So ladies and gentlemen, please join me in giving a warm welcome to George Friedman.
Thank you, Munir, for giving my entire speech. I will now discuss Donald Trump's hair. When I was last here, I discussed the European crisis. The European crisis has intensified and has been joined by a series of crises across the Eurasian landmass. And when I say Eurasia, I mean Europe and Asia, from the Atlantic to the Pacific, from the Arctic Ocean to the Indian Ocean. And it's noteworthy that every significant part of that landmass, with the exception of India, is in fundamental systemic crisis. And we have not seen a model like this really since World War II. This does not mean that I'm saying that we're going to have a war or anything else. I'm simply saying that the pattern is ominous. It is not yet deep in the sense of intractable, but it is broad. And we need to understand why it's that way. Because the world has now taken an interesting shape. Eurasia is in chaos, or close to it, in Europe, in Russia, in China, in Central Asia, in the Middle East, certainly. While North America and the Western Hemisphere in general is stable, relatively stable, not perfectly stable. But the great contrast that is developing in the world is the massive distinction between the two hemispheres in the way, including Latin America, is behaving. And the massive distinction that particularly exists between North America, NAFTA, and the various trade zones and alliance blocks in the Eastern Hemisphere. This is a pattern that will not emerge and then go away in 3 years. It is a fundamental shift, and an understandable and predictable one, I'll try to make, that really ushers in a new phase of human history. In my book, I wrote back in, published back in 2009, I wrote before then, the next 100 years, I spoke about the movement of history from Europe to North America, that North America was becoming the center of gravity of the international system, the stable pivot. This is part of that process, and as such is extremely important. So when we look at this crisis, we need to understand the engines. And many of the engines are simply local, and I'll go through them later, but the EU is poorly founded. The Russians are vulnerable to the price of oil. The Chinese are going through a cyclical downturn as Japan did before it. And the Middle East is the Middle East. But each of them have reasons. But there is an underlying reason that this is intensifying, which I call the crisis of the exporters. For over a century, it has been assumed that free trade is a necessary boon, and efficient exporters are in some way economically and perhaps even morally superior to poor exporters. And what has happened really since 2008 is a reversal in which heavy exporters have found themselves extremely vulnerable to shifts in the market, while those who are inefficient exporters are relatively immune. And since NAFTA is a fairly inward-facing institution, it has an immunity which the outward-facing entities, like the EU or China, don't have. The problem came about in 2008 with a massive downturn economically in the United States and Europe. For the United States, it was a relatively temporary affair. For Europe, it became a systemic crisis. And the problem was that Europe was China's largest customer. Not in Walmart, although close, it was Europe. And China was at a particular delicate moment historically when this struck. It had dedicated itself to full employment. It maintained full employment by promiscuously lending money, so the companies wouldn't go out of business. This led to inflation until goods manufactured in Mexico were cheaper than goods manufactured in China. This was the beginning of this moment. So its exports situation was already under deep pressure. When the appetite of the Europeans and the Americans for Chinese goods contracted, what was a serious problem became a destabilizing problem. The Chinese economy depended on exports for cash flow to pay debts in a debt-based economy. People borrowed money, not equity, and they had to pay it back. And deeper than that, with that destabilization that was happening, you found a fundamental political one that I'll talk about. One of the more interesting things is that the China myth, what I call the China bubble, really began exploding in 2010, 2011. But the lag between the time the global markets understood that this was the new normal of China, that China was not going back to that unique 20, 30 years of extraordinary growth, when that was understood, everything would change. But I remember that Business Week had a copy, in 1993, published an issue on the Japanese economic miracle, 1993, which is to say, not just the media, but the markets, and I don't understand this, but I want to understand it someday, continue to believe, against all evidence, that China would maintain its consumption of raw materials in spite of the downturn of exports. There was a belief, when you questioned people, that this was a passing phase and that China would return to what it was. An inability to understand this was not a passing phase, it was a secular shift in the way China worked. But a year ago, it became obvious that this was not a passing phase. A number of statistics were published by the Chinese. On one occasion, it was actually true. And it emerged that they were in serious trouble. And suddenly, the global commodity markets, all of them, absorbed the fact that China was not going to be pulling the engine, was not going to be pulling, you know, the train, and prices fell down. This had a staggering effect on, for example, Russia. Russia, for various reasons I'll talk about, is heavily dependent on energy exports to maintain its political system. Its entire domestic budget is built on oil prices. When oil prices fell down, they were smashed. We just published yesterday a study on Saudi Arabia and the decision to try to sell part of Aramco to give a sense how badly this smashed the Saudi economy. But it was not just them, it was also Australia and all of those that were heavy exporters. But you had, in the past, mineral exports under pressure, but the industrial goods in good shape. Industrial goods in good shape, mineral prices rising with them. You've never had a situation that I recall in which both mineral prices and industrial prices are under pressure, especially in exporting countries. So you have mineral exporters getting hammered, industrial exporters getting hammered, everybody who exports is getting hammered. So when we look around the world and we see the export levels, we see that Russia exports 30% of its GDP, mostly in energy. China, about 22%. Germany, 46%, and that remains the story. And the United States, 13%, of which 40% go to Mexico and Canada. So now we see the basic divergence. The United States is, relative to GDP, an inefficient exporter, and therefore not subject to the appetites of its customers. Those who are heavy exporters are subject to those appetites. Because you must always understand that when you're selling something, you have to have customers. And if your customers can't buy, and you've built your economy on the assumption of rising consumption, you'll stagger. And if you have built your economy around the idea that I will constantly sell minerals to exporting countries, industrial countries, and they don't have customers, it all
cascades backwards.
Let's now take it each individually and not look at this broader picture of destabilization, but let's take a look at each country, at each region that's in trouble. The fundamental problem of Europe is an attempt to take a country like Greece and a country like Germany and give them the same currency. Moreover, to leave in the hands of each individual country fiscal policy, while a central bank controls monetary policy, so there's no coherence between the two, and have one country so overwhelmingly powerful, Germany, that it has the ability to set the regulations of Brussels and the behavior of the European Central Bank, not because it's a conspiracy, because if you don't support the German economy, then it all comes tumbling down. You don't have Europe. There is no such thing except as a geopolitical, geographical expression. The unemployment rate south of the Alps is over 20%, somewhere 25%. That is the same rate the United States had during the Great Depression. The unemployment rate in Germany is 4.5%. The harmonization of these economies is not possible. And therefore, on virtually every other issue, they are unable to act. One of the funniest things I saw was a decision on the part of the EU, I can't figure out which commission because there's so many, that they would send help to the Greeks to patrol their shores to keep people out in June. Think on this. But this is a paralysis. It is a paralysis built in by the system. But bear in mind two things. There is a major crisis coming in the Italian banks. It's actually here. Italian banks, you have to disaggregate region and everything like that, have non-performing loan rates of 17 to 18%. I believe it's higher. You do not have 20% unemployment without a consumer debt crisis. This can't be. The Europeans have not had a consumer debt crisis, which means they're rolling over the debts in various ways so that they don't have to register it. How can you possibly have that sort of unemployment without massive mortgage defaults? But behind all this is the great bubble, Germany. Germany exports 47% of its GDP. I'm not good at arithmetic, so give me 50%. Which means that every time it loses 5% in exports, it loses 2.5% in GDP. Now, losing 2.5% of your GDP matters. But if you lose 15% of your exports, you've lost 7.5%. The point I'm making is Germany is on the edge of the volcano. It is a massive exporting power that has built its economy on the assumption of expanding demand for its goods, basically in the European free trade zone. And that can't happen now. Its entire structure is based on that because domestic consumption can only be raised so much when you have that much out there. Other countries are in this position, South Korea, for example. But only Germany is the fourth largest economy in the world. So the size of the imbalance relative to the global system is massive. Now, in a world in which you have an exporters crisis, and one of the greatest exporters in the world, Germany, with a larger dependence on exports than China or any other country that you might name, the global exporter, if you will, from a percentage point of view, has not yet had a decline, a significant decline in exports. Well, when the absolute numbers of significant decline don't fall, you have Japan in 1989. The margins have to be falling. They have to be, in some cases, negative. And there's only so long that Deutsche Bank can keep underwriting this, and it's pretty much, I suspect, out of time. In the meantime, what you have rising in Europe is the right. By the right, I do not mean brown shirts, but nationalists. People who are saying, this doesn't work, while the Financial Times swears it's working because the Northern European banks are in good shape. If you read the Financial Times, you read the voice of the European elite. And the European elite still believes they're having a banking crisis, rather than a systemic social failure. And that systemic social failure is going to result in massive changes in regimes and in the way regimes change. The tension that we see now between France and Germany is with a pro-European government, which will not stay in power unless it does this. A Cameron is forced, if he's going to stay in power, to call a referendum. So even the moderate regimes that you see have to tack away from the European Union. I don't believe the European Union will fail. I believe somewhere in some building, the League of Nations still has an office somewhere in Geneva. European institutions don't fail. They just become genteel in their poverty. But you already see precisely how Europe will fail. People will simply ignore what it says. There is no immigration crisis. Europe is 500 million people. We're talking about 1 million, I can't do the arithmetic, but it's less than 1%. There is no reason the Europeans can't handle it. They just can't decide on what to do. What this distinction has done has paralyzed the European institutional systems. It has also led to recriminations between government. Everybody knows that this whole thing is Hungary's fault. Blame the Hungarians this week. But this is a crisis of such fundamental proportions at the heart of the world, Europe. The Russian crisis is much simpler. Putin was unable to transform the wealth of $100 barrel oil into a viable economy. He wasn't able to because the forces that brought him to power, the FSB and the oligarchs, had to be satisfied in various ways. That money had to be diverted to support enterprises that, Rosneft, for example, that had to be maintained. And so he never had the room to maneuver to divert that money to build something more substantial. It now faces a catastrophic situation where the expectation of the Russians was $70 a barrel of oil at the bottom, and I don't know what it closed at today, but it's below that. The Russian Federation works with money being transferred to the central government distributing it to the oblasts, the various regions. And if the central government doesn't have the money to distribute to the oblasts, well, there is no terror going on that's frightening a governor to obey. He'll go his own way. In Europe, fragmentation consists of nobody paying attention. In Russia, fragmentation consists of nobody receiving benefits from the central government and therefore pursuing their own interests in whatever direction it goes. In China, what we have seen is a cyclical crisis. You cannot sustain that level of growth permanently. No matter what Goldman Sachs said, it can't beat the United States. You cannot start where they are and in a sprint over 40, 50 years surpass a century deep government. What you do is what Japan did. You reach a point where you cannot sustain it and you reach a new normal. You've had a new normal in Japan. People talk about the lost generation. This was not lost from the Japanese point of view. They maintained full employment. They were feeding their people. There was not unrest. Only American investors felt it was lost. There were no opportunities. The Japanese apologized, but they hadn't built their economy for Westerners to profit. But they were stable. China cannot reach a new normal. Because in China, by Chinese statistics, 600 million Chinese have incomes below $2 a day, household incomes. 440 million Chinese have incomes of $2 to $4 a day. China is an extraordinarily poor country, a fact you can miss if you fly into Pudong and have one of those dinners where you mortgage your house and go to your hotel. But if you go to China, rather than this American extension into China, Shanghai, you discover a country of enormous poverty. This is where Mao Zedong took the long march. The long march when he went to Yan'an and raised an army and came back after two decades and shut down the country to create equality. And this is where this holiday, people who had gone to Shanghai or Guangdong with dreams, went home never to come back, let go from their jobs. The issue here is not what is the Chinese stock market doing. It is an irrelevancy, really, to the entire thing. It is what are these people going to do with shattered lives? In a country that has a tradition of Maoism, which is why you see Xi desperately trying to expropriate that tradition of Maoism. He wants to own it, and then hold it in two ways. First, he is the heir, and second, he will strike at any organization that threatens him. China has become a dictatorship because the alternative in China is regional fragmentation. The real issue here is whether China returns to a form of Maoism or whether it goes back behind Maoism to regionalism. And the regionalism will be the Chinese Communist Party fragmenting. Why? Because if you are in Shanghai and you're making a great deal of money from your relationship to Apple, you have a greater interest in that relationship than you have to Beijing's latest demand for the transfer of money. Or you're so afraid of Beijing that you'll transfer the money. And this is the great, not very sophisticated, but very great question of China. Will the party committee in the coastal regions be more afraid of the secret police or less afraid of secret police and more desirous for their relationship with the West? And this, by the way, up until 1947, was the nature of China. These are the two Chinas. The China of Mao, the China of Chiang Kai-shek and Sun Yat-sen. It is not self-evident that it won't be one of these choices, but it is the least likely that it will return to the way it was for the past generation. There's no path back to that right now. And this is why Xi is conducting intense purges. He's discovered, to his shock, that there's corruption going on in China. That's not the point. What he is doing is eliminating opponents, fragmenting elites that could rise up against him, and generally creating a sense of insecurity within the Chinese Communist Party so that any fragmentation in the party won't happen. He's also, of course, playing a game in South China Sea. That's not a trivial game, but it's not a serious one. However, it is designed to do exactly what the Russians did in Syria. Aside from whatever strategic benefits they had, Putin has 80% popularity. That's no kidding. In the same way that George W. Bush was enormously popular in the first 6 months after 9/11, nations rally. And the Chinese nation will rally to a confrontation. Not 2 years worth, 6 months worth. And what everybody is doing on that continent, that massive two continents, we'll call it, is playing with fire to maintain political stability. In the Middle East, you have had the collapse of the states that Europe invented. Syria was an invention, Lebanon was an invention, Jordan was an invention, Israel was an invention, Iraq was an invention. They all had origins of sorts, but many of them, particularly Syria and Iraq, no longer exist. They don't exist because at a certain point the United States decided it was not going to take responsibility, as the British might have, for the future of the region. Not necessarily a stupid decision, but one with consequences. And the consequence was that the most natural force in the region, Islam, the most embittered force in the region, Islam, began to form new entities. This will sort itself out, as Lebanon did, because Lebanon is the example. In 1970s, Lebanon fragmented. The national government collapsed, and Lebanon consisted of various fragments fighting each other. You now have the Lebanese model transferred to Syria and Iraq. And now the Saudis are desperately worried because they themselves are a faction, the House of Saud, that came to power under British mentorship, if you will. They look at the price of oil. They look at the stability of the royal family that expects to be paid, of those not within the tribe who also expect to be paid. They took their crisis, and they're frightened. So now you have, flowing out of that, the Arabian Peninsula itself on the cusp, to the point where the great triumph of the Saudis was the nationalization of Aramco. And the Crown Prince raises the question, we might sell 5%. This is the equivalent of selling rugs out of your house to pay the rent. And it strikes at the heart of the legitimacy of Saudi nationalism, such as it is. We also see these crises merging. The European Middle Eastern crisis on multiple levels. Immigrants, terrorism, French, British fighters, you know, deploying to the region. Nothing intense yet, but merging. The Russian-European relationship is merging, not just over the question of Ukraine, but certainly over the question of Ukraine, because that's vital. The Russian-Middle East relationship is merging, with the Russians intervening. And in the middle of all this, note one nation that intersects everything. Intersects the European crisis, intersects the Russian crisis, intersects the Middle Eastern crisis, Turkey. Desperately trying not to get in, having no way to stay out. You will watch Turkey. One of the things I predicted in that book I had mentioned was the rise of Turkey. Not because there's a vast conspiracy, but because everything is going to fall apart around it. And the Europeans are now going to the Turks to try to make a deal on refugees. The Russians are shooting at them, and vice versa. The Americans are demanding the Turks do something about Syria. Turkey. But that is not the most important thing. The most important fact of the world is the United States exports 13% of its GDP, and effectively really about 7% of its GDP outside of. And that makes the United States, who has always been criticized as being non-competitive, in an enormously comfortable position. It is also the United States that's withdrawing from this region, is not involved in Europe, is not involved in the Middle East the way it's supposed to be, is playing kabuki game with the Chinese. The Russians are a more interesting question of how we will play them. But the United States now has the option of what Goethe called elective affinities. It does not have to marry. It does not have to engage. It may withhold. This is not, incidentally, isolationism. It's called prudence. And this changes the American position in the world dramatically. We all believe, because we're Americans, that times have never been as terrible as this. This is a religious faith. And there's problems. But the relative position of the United States compared to all other great powers is incomparable. What has happened since 2008 was that a stupid American idea, subprime loans, was bought by even stupider people in Europe. I always say the guy who bought it is dumber than the one who sold it. And that has pyramided. But if it wasn't that, it would be some other thing. The entire Eastern Hemisphere, each of these countries was standing on a volcano. And whatever was going to set off the volcano, they were all going to fry. The last time I saw a pattern like this was World War II. It was the last time that all of Eurasia was somehow involved in a destabilization. It is very difficult to imagine this turning into a war. For one thing, none of these countries have the energy for a war. By energy, I mean the sheer moral power to do it. But you cannot ignore the fact that whatever subjectively I might think, the pattern is enormously ominous. The most ominous part of this, and I'll stop there, is this fact. I think the Russians are going to be very aggressive, and I think the Russian Federation will go the way of the Soviet Union for the same reasons. High defense costs, low energy prices. That took down the Soviet Union. That will, I think, take down Russia. When the Soviet Union collapsed, all nuclear weapons under American tutelage was transferred to the Soviet Union so that Kazakhstan wouldn't have a nuclear capability, which we all think is a good idea. If the Russian Federation collapses, what happens to those nuclear weapons? The frightening thing about Russia is that it is a nuclear power, and if it fragments, something has to be done about it. And there really isn't anything that can be done. What do you do? That's one theory. The other thing to look at is the entire center. I haven't talked about Central Asia, but give me that. The center of the Eurasian landmass is being hollowed out. We see one country already emerging, Turkey. The real power that has always been the dominant power in East Asia, Japan, is now beginning to sense itself. And Poland, in most dealings with the Russians or anyone else, is far more influential than Germany, who is paralyzed by fear of what happens to exports. So we are in a position where the world is rotating. The world always rotates. Everybody thinks it'll go back to the way it was. It never does. And those who understand that will fret more than others. But we are now at a turning point where last time I came here and spoke to you about the inherent weakness of Europe, I now have to go to a broader picture. A fundamental destabilization of a hemisphere, while the other hemisphere, ours, remains oddly but explainably immune. And this becomes the real issue. We are now the imperial power, if you will, in the sense of being the most stable, powerful country in the world. How do we handle this? What is there to be done? And the answer is, I don't know, but I will ask.
Well, thank you very much. We'll now open up to audience Q&A. If you have a question, please raise your hand. We have mics in the audience, and please make sure your question is a question. Take the gentleman in the pink shirt there, Kevin, please.
Good evening, Mr. Friedman. So, given everything that you've just said, what would you say a good solution, in particularly with dealing with the European debt crisis, would be? Should we get rid of the euro? Should we maybe shrink the European Union? What possible solutions would you, for lack of a better term, embrace?
Well, geopolitics is not a form of engineering. It is not a matter of choice. It is what is going to happen. The euro is unsustainable. The euro is unsustainable because the simple solutions that might be available to an Italy now, between the regulations that the European Union has put on them and the fact they don't have anything to devalue, okay, and they have to pay it back in euros, is unsustainable. So what will happen are defaults. The Hungarian model is the one. Hungarians, homeowners, borrowed money for mortgages denominated in euros, Swiss francs, and yen. No kidding. The forint fell. Prime Minister Orban, who is disliked by everyone, except the Hungarian public, basically said to the bankers, okay, here's the deal. You're going to get paid back in forints. It's going to be about 60 cents on a dollar. It was more complicated than that, but it came down to that. Or I got another deal for you. You get nothing. Give me a call in the morning. Tell me what you have in mind. They called. They said, we'll take what you got. The imposition of the solution by the debtor in a situation where the creditor has no option is something pioneered by American Airlines. It's not something unknown. So the answer is not what policy I think will have. Nobody listens to me. But what I think will happen, and watch the Hungarians. I happen to be born there, and this is a strange moment. They're actually prophetic.
Next question. Here, Kevin, just in the middle of the second row here. Thanks.
You confused everybody.
I did a little bit, yeah.
Well, you had, in your book, you had said that, you know, Poland, Czech, Turkey, Czech, Japan, Czech. You also mentioned that a long-term country the United States should be interested in is Mexico. Do you still feel that way? And do you think the decision that our country will be making in this election cycle regarding immigration policy, where the parties are you know, vastly apart, will that have any influence on what you see happening there long term?
American policy on immigration will remain consistent. Do everything you can to stop it, but make certain you don't. This is a very old American policy that will not be unseated. Look, when you visit Mexico, north of Mexico City, and you visit cities like Querétaro and Aguascalientes, where the largest automobile factory in the Western Hemisphere is located, or where Bombardier is building jets, you are in one country. When you go south of Puebla, not Cancun, you are in another country. This is Mexico's wealth. The North is capable of sustaining advanced industrial projects. The South can replace China as a low-wage, high-growth region. It is now, I think, the 15th largest economy. By PPP, it's 11th. The question is not whether Mexico is a large country. It is. It also has a deep relationship with the United States on trade. And frankly, there are no immigrants coming north anymore. And one of my greatest pleasures is to go down there and talk to some officials saying, we got a real problem with the Guatemalans. We can't keep them out. I love that. This is a presidential campaign, and virtually everything said is irrelevant in two ways. First, they're lying. And second, the president has no power. The American president does not decide anything. The American president has two houses by completely whacked out rules, able to stop anything, and a Supreme Court that is utterly unpredictable. This is what the founders wanted. They did not like government, so they built a special city in a swamp like Canberra and Brasilia. Please remember, Washington is one of those cities. And they put everybody there. I love hearing what presidents are going to do. Obama gave away his entire political heritage to get one-third of the health care bill he wanted, and he never got anything else. I enjoy the elections. I bet on them. It's just a wonderful show. I love Donald Trump. I mean, just how could you not? What country, what a great country to have anybody could be president. But again, there's a commonality between these two questions. History is not an engineering problem. It is not a bunch of people getting together at the Brookings Institution and crafting a good position paper. History rolls over policymakers, dreamers. The trick is to understand where it's going, not where it should go.
Next question. Front corner here. Thanks. Let's wait for the microphone, please. Sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry. July 23rd, England votes to stay in the EU or not. It seems like it's 50-50 at the moment. If they pull out of the EU, is that a self-contained event, or is that, will that have very serious later cascading consequences?
If they pull out of the Union, they will do what they want. If they stay in the Union, they will do what they want. The idea of membership over the past 3 months over the immigration crisis has shifted dramatically. It once was that we were constrained by the decision makers in Brussels. But if you look at the question of borders, of Schengen and all that, none of that is in the hands of these of the bureaucracy or the decision making. I wrote a piece 2 or 3 days ago basically saying by June, I don't think it'll matter how they vote. Because if the question is Britain going to have the right to govern itself as it wishes? The answer is whether it votes in or out, it will. And we're past the point of what it means to stay in or out.
Next question. In the just second in from the aisle there.
What role, you mentioned briefly about India, but what role do you see for India and Iran, two countries which you didn't mention? I mean, you mentioned India, but not Iran at all.
They go into two different buckets. The question of India is whether it will become a country or whether it will remain divided into 40 pieces of British imperialism. If it remains fragmented, it will do what's called a dead man bounce now, because somebody's got to go up, which is what it's doing. But it can't sustain it, because it's not a country in terms of economy and regulation and things like that. This is a historic opportunity for India, but never underestimate the ability of Indians to miss historical opportunities. So I suspect that very little will happen. As for Iran, it is now in a very different game than it was. The United States has essentially taken its hands off the wheel. And there are four great powers in the region that can't leave: Israel, Turkey, Iran, Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia is a question mark. But let's say there's four. The American strategy is to be not particularly friendly with anyone and not particularly hostile to anyone. So it is drawn a bit closer to the Iranians, a bit farther from the Israelis, deals with the Turks. This is called learning what the Romans did, learning what the British did, the balance of power. You don't send main force. The British never sent its entire military force into India. They played the various factions against each other and used local forces. And this is what you're seeing. At this point, the Iranian problem is Turkey, which is what the United States wants. The American problem is to make sure the Turks become more aggressive. The Turkish problem is, please do not draw me into your game. The American solution is, come to me, baby. So when we look at the situation for Iran, totally different from the Indian situation, we're seeing India drawn into the regional system precisely by getting what it wanted, the sanctions lifted. Its greatest benefit was the sanctions, because it kept them out of the game. Now they have no choice. They must be involved in Iraq. Iraq fundamentally affects them. They therefore are doing what the United States would like them to do. The Russians are doing what the Americans want them to do. The United States does not want Assad to fall now. Now. Later, yes. Earlier, yes. Now, no, because of ISIS. The United States could not save Assad for political reasons, domestic and foreign. The Russians come in, they save Assad, they leave the question of ISIS open for the United States to deal with to the extent it wants. And what the United States is doing very brilliantly, and I know we're not supposed to be smart, but it's unintentional, what the United States is doing very brilliantly is forcing all the other players to do what it wants, because we have learned a fundamental lesson. You do not maintain a global power by constantly rushing multi-divisional forces into a region. You get tired. You must learn the balance of power, and it's being learned. And the important thing is, I don't know if Obama knows he's doing it or not. You are pulled into this because you must, because you don't have other options. He doesn't have the option of sending forces. So Iran must be understood in terms of the new American game.
Anyone else? On the far side there? Thanks.
First of all, great description on the Trump hair. I really appreciate your presentation. I'm from Romania. I'm the Trade Commissioner of Romania. Just a few comments.
You're the what?
I'm the Trade Commissioner of Romania. And just a few comments and then a question regarding the Europe or the Euros. I believe that we are facing two Europes, the Northern Europe and the Southern Europe, and we have to find a way, we have to find the place of France in this equation, because they have a Northern ambition, but they are in the Southern Europe. And I believe that there are two forces that are trying to balance the influence that Russia has in the region. And I can tell you that I think that China and Turkey have the power to do that. Besides that, other countries, even, I don't know, Poland or Hungary or Romania, they are not willing or they don't have the force to do that. So the question is, how do you see Romania or the Eastern Europe or the Central Europe in the future? And how do you see it split it between North and South, or how the things are going to be in the future? Thank you.
I spend a lot of time in Romania, so. There are four Europes. Southern Europe, Northern Europe, Maritime Europe, Britain, Scandinavia, and what I'll call Eastern Europe, because I'm old. But each of them are different. Each of them have their own interests. Central Europe, Southern Europe have no interest in providing security for Eastern Europe. It has no value to them. The French will go south and north, east and west. They will go as they want. They will not do what you want. What is emerging in the East, however, is an alliance structure, a bilateral relationship between the United States and Poland, a bilateral relationship between the United States and Romania, which is getting deeper and deeper, a relationship with the Baltics, and what the Hungarians do, I don't know. But General Pilsudski, who was the founder of the modern Polish Republic, had the vision of something called the Intermarium, an alliance system running from the Baltics to the Black Sea. Romania will arm because it has to, not because it wants to, because it feels like it, because it knows what catastrophe looks like. All you have to say is Ceausescu, and now it's clear what the alternative is. The Poles will arm because they have to. And with those two foundations, and possibly Turkey now that Russia has done what it's done, the United States is deeply involved in backing these two. This is the sole exception to the isolationist vision I would give. But it is a unique one in the sense that it is not a commitment of massive US force, but the promise of force in the event of need. and the provision of arms, prepositioning troops, clearing Costanza, and all sorts of things. So the answer to the question is, the model that is emerging is there. What is interesting in the model is that it really does involve NATO. I mean, yes, there's a Danish officer who comes by once in a while. But what it really involves is the United States and this region in bilateral relations. And as Trade Commissioner, this provides you a tremendous opportunity, because where the US Army goes, so goes investment.
Next question. Here in the red tie.
What do you think will happen with the migrant crisis this year and beyond in Europe?
It'll go on. You have desperate people and a place that's safe. Having been a refugee myself, I know that the math of this is impeccable. I want to go from here to there. And there are many of me. And on the other side is the Greeks and a potential naval force run by a committee that don't even speak the same language. So you won't stop them. But that's not the problem. Europe wants this to be a massive immigrant problem, a million people. The United States solved a situation in which 20 million people were without homes in Europe. This is an eminently soluble problem historically. The Europeans cannot agree how to solve it. And this is the fundamental problem. And because the Europeans don't know how to solve it, it won't be solved. But it goes to the deepest question: is there any longer such a thing as a European Union, aside from a name and very thick studies?
Next question. Just the second row back there. Thanks.
I had a quick follow-up question on Iran. And given that the sanctions on the US are lifted, do you ever think that Iran ever is going to be able to develop a domestic market with real purchasing power? And if so, would Germany and the more export-independent countries benefit from that and kind of move away from the edge of the volcano?
Iran cannot pick up the surplus of the German economy. It is an interesting market to enter. The Iranians have not yet set the regulations for entering it. And American exporters are risk averse. Europeans are too. What are the rules? You also have a very large merchant class in the bazaars who are not eager to see Carrefour set up shop right across from them. This government is heavily dependent on that class. Rouhani really depends on them. It's not the peasants, it is the urban merchant class. And he has to keep them happy. So theoretically, the market is opened. As a practical question, it's a question of what the Iranians are capable of allowing. Because remember, the entry of Western exports into Iran will transform Iranian society, but not neatly. It'll be a wreckage. So if Walmart, Carrefour, whoever, go into the markets, its impact on the urban merchant class will be enormous. And Rouhani's not crazy. He got himself this deal. That's his legacy. He would like to get out of town fast before they catch up with him. So I don't see Iran, because of internal processes, transforming anything for a while.
Next question, Phil Levy in the front row. Thank you.
Thank you. We have the G20 meeting this week in China, and there's calls from the IMF and others for fiscal stimulus, things to get the world economy going. Given your statements about the inability to engineer and history rolling over things, do you think the G20 is a waste of time, and have they done anything useful in the past, such as in the wake of the global financial crisis?
On dead days, they've given people like me something to write about. Very little, but I can make up something from it. These existed, The G7 and things like this are Cold War relics. During the Cold War, there were various alliance structures, and it was felt that the leading economies should meet and collaborate. Like many Cold War entities, they continue to exist. And they come to include Russia, except Russia's a bad boy, so we're not going to let him in, or what have you. The problem is not that they have such fundamentally different interests. Not different interests simply in they disagree. They're not even discussing the same topic. So I think it's good because it takes, you know, 20 ministers of finance and takes them off the street, and they can't do anything for a couple of days. I don't mean this to be, it is not the ministers of finance. It is the very concept that we're going to get together and manage the global system, the World Affairs Council, the World Economic Forum vision, that we're all going to sit here and we'll know each other, and so we will solve our problems. The problems are pyramiding and are beyond control. And how, you know, in a conversation between, I pick two countries, I don't even know who the G20 is. Turkey is a member of that. And Brazil. They like each other, by the way. What do they have to say to each other? The Brazilians are going to discuss the question of Russian intrusion in the region. And the Turks are going to discuss the scandal in the oil industry. There's no common vocabulary.
This question, the second row back here, thank you.
If we can turn to the Mexico situation for a second. You call out in one of the reality checks, you call out three kind of call it challenges that Mexico faces going forward. Informal labor, or maybe we can call that the shadow economy to a certain degree, infrastructure and security. What is the prediction for when and how Mexico can get through these challenges, and then what role could a, you know, a good trading partner, for example, its northern neighbor, play in helping them through that challenge?
Well, let me first say that article was not written by me, but by Alison Federka, and I say this because her parents are sitting right here, and they should be acknowledged. And she knows far more about Mexico than I do. The real issue, Mexico has benefited enormously from its membership in NAFTA, as the United States has, as the Canadians do. It needs to take a leading role in Central America to mobilize the labor there. And in this, its natural partner is Colombia, which has an interest in Panama and so on. There's an evolution, I think, that will go on, because I think Brazil is fundamentally incapable of carrying out this role, in which Mexico will oddly be both a North American and a South American country. And in doing that, it will become an investment center in what I think will be one of the fastest growing regions in the world. The problem it has is institutional. It doesn't have any. Or its institutions were built for a third world country. And this is a problem with many of these emerging markets. They've emerged, yet they don't have the institutions. Nor do they have the vision to understand what they've gotten. So in Romania, I spend my time trying to convince them they're a real country and they should start taking responsibility. I have the same problem in Mexico, where I meet with Mexicans and try to explain to them, look, you are not a third world country. You have characteristics of it, but you are potentially the leading power in the Latin world. And they giggle and laugh and make faces at me because they don't take themselves seriously. And one of the biggest problems in the world at this moment is a whole new tier of countries are emerging with the old ones in chaos, and they don't believe in themselves. They don't believe it's happening. They don't believe they are who they are. And this is what I mean. I can talk to them until I'm blue in the face. It's not going to help. So what is it that Mexico must do, the single thing? understand what it's become. Not forget what it was, but understand what it's become. And that is here in Poland, in Romania, in Turkey, throughout the world that is going to dominate the 21st century, the power, the problem. Interestingly, when the United States in the 19th century was in the same position, we believed we really were rulers of the world, even though we were a third world country. So the generation that came up then had enormous confidence. The generation that we're dealing with now, and Mexico is very much among them, doesn't have that. So, because I didn't have the answer to your question, I answered another much better one, and I think you should appreciate that.
Next question, down here in the front row, Wei-Shin. Thank you. So just a second person in there. No, this row, thanks.
I appreciate all the realism that you've shared with us tonight. Can you, as we're getting towards the ending, can you give us kind of your rosy-eyed, optimistic case of how the world could prosper in the next generation or so?
Well, we have to fundamentally restructure our understanding of economics. Monetarism clearly does not explain what's happening today. Keynesianism really doesn't grasp it. Since all economists are religious people, and they believe that next week it'll explain, but we really don't have a theory of what's happening. We don't have a theory of deflation and the interaction of deflation with money supply, because it's not working the right way. We don't understand free trade. We have made a religious assumption that it's always good, even though the United States was a protectionist country, and Germany in the 1950s was a protectionist country. Nevertheless, so we are going through a wrenching period in which the reality has shifted so deeply that we don't yet grasp how deeply it's shifted. We have no models. I mean, I'm trying to develop a geopolitical model, which certainly isn't going to help your local economist. But there is no model for truly understanding the way in which the world behaves, which shows us the interaction between economics and politics. One part that I would argue very strongly. When Adam Smith wrote, he wrote something called Political Economy, and he wrote something called The Wealth of Nations, not How to Make $1 Million in 2 years. He understood that the idea that there's a distinction between politics and economics died when the limited liability corporation was invented. When the government said, all right, you don't have to be liable in proportion to what you own, the distinction ended. It was a constant interplay between politics and economics. But the model has changed now. It changed after the Cold War and changed when the United States became the global hegemon, and didn't want to be, and didn't know it was. So many things have changed in the past 20, 30 years that we have not yet begun to grasp them. The challenge we have is we're trying to grasp them at the same time as we're running. So we're all doing the work we do, making the investments, the political decisions. At the same time, we're trying to get a hold of our breath and say, what in God's name is happening to us? This is normal. This happened during the French Revolution, at other definitive moments in history. This is not the French Revolution, but it is a definitive moment. The core, definitive fact is that Europe is no longer the center of the world. The United States is. Everything pivots on understanding that. And everything flows out of it. And the United States is not a European country. Doesn't want to be a European country, will not elect a president who went to the Ecole Supérieure, but really likes a guy who likes pizza. My point is that we are so different and we have no sense of ourselves. So to directly answer your question, there will be a very difficult period, particularly in the United States, to about 1930. It'll be primarily economic, and it's faced simply by this. The median income for somebody in the United States household is $51,000, 50% below, 50% above. In California, that translates into $39,000. I picked California because they got tax rates like you never saw. $39,000. That's the middle class income. Maybe you can buy a house. Maybe. maybe I'll buy a car. The lower middle class, where I come from, hardcore Queens, New York, they're out of the game. The issue is not inequality. The issue is that effective demand is evaporating. And the issue is that this will be solved politically, not economically, because it's creating it. And by my count, by the end of the next decade, we will be in a very serious position, a bifurcated society. Now, there's nothing to stop it. We're not going to stop it. We will solve it. So what I'm saying is that in the 1920s, we worried about Europe. In the 2020s, 30s, you worry about the United States, because that leads where everybody's going to go. And you got a leader who has no idea where it has been or where it's going. So there's no rosy picture right now. Except, you know, people will be born, die, they'll have children. It'll be all right.
Well, that seems like an appropriately somber place to end.
About which, having children?
For me. Well, thank you very much for joining us. Please take a chance to buy the book. And we'll put it up. Thank you.